From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello and welcome to this JAMA Author Interviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Preeti Malani, JAMA Deputy Editor. I'm joined by Dr. Joel Dulhunty and Dr. Jason Roberts, both of whom are from the Royal Brisbane and Women's Hospital and the University of Queensland. Drs. Dulhunty and Roberts are authors on two related articles. The first is titled, Continuous versus Intermittent Beta-Lactam Antibiotic Infusions in Critically Ill Patients with Sepsis, the BLING 3 Randomized Clinical Trial. And the second is titled, Prolonged versus Intermittent Infusions of Beta-Lactam Antibiotics in Adults with Sepsis or Septic Shock, a Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis. Both articles were published in JAMA on June 12, 2024, in conjunction with the Critical Care Research Meeting in Belfast, Ireland. Joel and Jason, congratulations on these important publications, and thank you for making time to join this conversation.
Pleasure to be here, Preeti.
Sepsis is a major cause of mortality worldwide. Treatment of sepsis includes early and appropriate antibiotic therapy. Traditionally, beta-lactams have been administered as short intermittent infusions. But because of time-dependent kill characteristics, there is a biological rationale that continuous infusion may be more effective than intermittent administration. However, prior clinical trials have not provided conclusive evidence that prolonged infusion of beta-lactams improves patient-centered outcomes, including mortality. Which brings us to the BLING 3 study. BLING 3 is a large, multinational, randomized clinical trial that included more than 7,000 adult patients with sepsis. This trial evaluated whether continuous versus intermittent infusion of a beta-lactam agent, either piperacillin tazobactam or meropenem, resulted in decreased all-cause mortality at 90 days in critically ill patients with sepsis. So with that introduction, Joel, please briefly tell us about the BLING 3 trial. What was involved and what were the key findings?
Well, Preeti, the BLING 3 trial was a huge undertaking. It was a large phase 3 clinical trial that involved over 7,000 patients from 104 intensive care units in 7 countries and was conducted over 5 years. And there were over 132,000 doses of study drug administered, and approximately 4 million data points were collected. It was a pragmatic trial that compared continuous and short intermittent infusions for two common beta-lactam antibiotics that were selected by the clinicians to treat sepsis and used the same 24-hour dose that was chosen by the clinician, regardless of which group participants were randomized to. We found a 2% difference in 90-day mortality between the two treatment groups, with lower mortality in patients that receive continuous infusion. Our confidence interval around the effect size ranged from 5% in favor of continuous infusions to 1% in the opposite direction. This led us to conclude that there is possibly no difference between the two methods of administration, or there is a possible clinically important benefit with using continuous infusions for patients receiving beta-lactam antibiotics for the treatment of sepsis.
Well, this was an impressive undertaking indeed. Joel, did anything about the study or the results surprise you?
Yes. While we hypothesized there would be a difference, we were impressed by the consistent picture that emerged in favor of continuous infusion across the study outcomes. We found that patients who received continuous infusions had a 6% higher rate of clinical cure and a median difference of 4 more days out of hospital than patients who received intermittent infusions. Another surprising result was the consistent effect on 90-day mortality across the subgroups we looked at, with no notable differences based on the antibiotic used, the illness severity, or the source of infection.
The second article is a systematic review and meta-analysis of 18 randomized trials that looked at a similar question. Does administration of beta-lactam antibiotics by prolonged infusion reduce 90-day mortality compared with intermittent infusion in adult patients with sepsis or septic shock? Jason, you led the work around the meta-analysis. Can you briefly discuss the study and the key findings?
Yes, thank you, Preeti. So this is a very topical area of clinical interest, and there have been a number of randomized controlled trials over the past 20 years at least, which have aimed to quantify the effect of prolonged infusion. So this is considering in terms of either a continuous infusion of a β-Lactam or an extended infusion, which is still a longer infusion than what's given as standard. Typically, an extended infusion would run for half of the dosing interval. So comparing that prolonged infusion versus a short intermittent infusion of β-Lactams. And so this particular systematic review and meta-analysis looked at it in the context of 90-day mortality in critically ill adults with sepsis or septic shock. The 18 studies identified included 9,108 critically ill adults. The principal finding was that the risk of all-cause 90-day mortality for prolonged infusions was 14% lower than in patients that received short intermittent infusions. Indeed, there was a 99.1% posterior probability that prolonged infusions were associated with a lower 90-day mortality. Prolonged infusions were also associated with a reduced risk of ICU mortality, and that was a result that had a high certainty, and an increase in clinical cure, and that had a moderate certainty.
Are there any limitations from a practical standpoint of this approach?
Yeah, I think that there are some potential challenges associated with prolonged infusion administration, and it's really around the practicalities of the potential instability of some drugs, particularly the carbapenems, so like meropenem in this case, is less stable than piperacillin tazobactam or other drugs. And there's also the issues associated with incompatibility of other drugs when the antimicrobial is being administered through the same line or through the Y site. So we do suggest in our protocol we had a dedicated intravenous port for administration. And this can represent some effect on workload, but actually previous studies have shown that the overall workload over the course of the day is less if you only have to make one infusion over the course of the day as opposed to several short infusions. But the instability for meropenem in particular is important. What our practical approach was in the study is that we would have 3 8-hour infusions of the drug used throughout the course of the day. And that was something which we didn't receive any feedback about that being problematic. So it is a consideration which is required prior to implementation, but it's certainly not a problematic obstacle by any means.
I'd like to shift to the clinical implications of these two very important studies. And I'll preface our discussion by saying at my hospital, at the University of Michigan Hospital, we are using prolonged infusions for most β-lactams, certainly in the ICU setting and several other places. And I'll add that this is a relatively recent change. We've been doing it for about a year and a half. So I'd like to ask each of you how these results should inform patient care in the ICU and beyond. I'll start with Joel.
The results of these two studies provide important complementary evidence to guide antibiotic management and improve outcomes for patients with sepsis. Our trial demonstrates that a safe and a relatively simple change to current antibiotic management can improve outcomes from sepsis.
Thank you, Joel. Jason, I'll ask you the same question. How should these results inform patient care in the ICU?
So I think that they provide some very important detail. The number needed to treat for prolonged infusion of β-Lactam antibiotic infusions to prevent one death was 1 in 26 patients. So that's quite a meaningful statistic. As mentioned previously, there's an increased probability of clinical cure as well as reduced risk of mortality at ICU discharge. Altogether, this cumulative data present a high degree of certainty for clinicians to consider prolonged infusions of β-Lactam antibiotics as a standard of care in the management of sepsis and septic shock. It's worthwhile noting that a recent survey of intensive care unit practice of antimicrobial use found that about 60% of ICUs before the results of this study came out were using prolonged infusions of β-Lactams. I think it supports the other 40% changing to use of prolonged infusions of β-Lactams, and certainly that is an approach which our intensive care unit in Brisbane will be moving towards.
It'll be very interesting in the coming months and years to see how this important work really moves the field forward. Drs. Dulhunty and Roberts, thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Preeti.
This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.